I got a lot of great feedback from my top 10 3D printing tips video. And what I wanted to do is take that same cool subject, but approach it from the aspect of design. Learning to design for 3D modeling and for 3D printing is by far the most challenging aspect of getting into 3D printing. So I'm gonna give you 10 quick tips to help get you started and really take your projects to the next level. The best place to get started with 3D design software, at least my recommendation, is with Autodesk. They are definitely the kings of 3D design software, and what's really cool is they have a ton of free beginner type software to get started with. So first thing I'm going to show you is you can go to 123dapp.com, and it's got all these great free programs to get you started. My favorite, 123D Design. Now, 123D Design works great on your PC, Mac, or even your iPad. So that's definitely my favorite. I've got it open right now. I like 123D Design because it's so easy to learn when you first start out. It is very intuitive, and you have the basic mouse functions and everything else. And it also is very intuitive as you move up into Autodesk's more advanced software. Now, 123D Design is my favorite to get started with, but they also have some other great options like Tinkercad. And really the only difference between Tinkercad and 123D Design is the layout is just a little bit different. So it also has tons of great functions, and the easiest thing to do is to try both and figure out which one you like the best. Another cool option out there that if you just want to start playing around more than actually getting in designing to as you first start out, they have another awesome new program called TinkerPlay, which is free, and it's available for your Mac or Windows or even for your Android tablet. And what's cool about TinkerPlay is what it really is it basically has a real basic setup for building posable figures, and it's really easy to use, and it's super, super fun just to get started. You don't have to have really any design experience at all to get started with it. So if you want to build robot monsters, go to TinkerPlay to get started. The next thing I wanted to talk about is designing your designs in terms of thinking about how they'll print out. And there's one super easy trick that you can always use, and that is called designing in halves. So this is like a blaster that I designed a while back for one of my early figures, and it's a little complex. I could try to use some of these angles down here and try to figure out how to make them only 45 degrees so I could print it straight up and down like this. Well, there's always a default backup that you can always do, and I call it the law of printing in halves. All you really have to do with any design is turn it on its side and then just split the model in half. Let me show you how I would do it in 123D Design software has or gives you the ability to split any model in half. Even it doesn't really matter how complex that model is. Well, the easiest way to do it in 123D Design is just build some type of box that covers your model, like I did right here. It's just a box that's approximately the same size or so of my model, and all I'm going to do is I'm going to basically take this box and I'm going to go about halfway through my model. Now, remember, if you're designing for a professional company, yeah, you'd want to be precise. But when you're printing on your home 3D printer, as long as you're close, you're going to be fine. And what's really cool is in 123D Design, they have this really simple to use function called split. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to split this model by using these two shapes. So the first thing I do is I select the body that I want to split, which is this piece right here. All right, and then I'm going to click on this and then select the body that I want to use to split my model. So I click on that, and then I just click off for the action to actually take place. Now what I've done is I've split my model, so I'll just delete this box. And now my model is actually in two. As you can see, all I really did was I just split my model right down the middle. And what that gives me is two obviously separate sides. Now watch how easy this is. All I have to do is split this thing apart into two pieces. Take the bottom piece and rotate it 180. All right, now both of these pieces are going to both of these pieces are going to print out just fine. And what's cool about it is all I have to do is once I take it off my print bed is just glue them together. And I can either do that with some regular glue, or of course I could just do the melting process, which I'll show you at a later time. But it's pretty cool. There's tons of tricks to melt plastic together into one piece. But now I can take a super complex design like this, and what I've done is I've made it flat on the bottom into, and I just split it into two pieces, and now it'll print out great. Whichever program you decide to use, one of the coolest tricks you can use is keyboard shortcuts. It saves you a ton of time, and most 3D design programs have them. You just have to go to the options and find them. And a lot of times when I'm learning a new type of software, I will find the keyboard shortcuts key here, and I'll just go ahead and print it out and tape it to my desk, and it'll save you a truckload of time, and it helps you do some of the most common things that you use for 3D printing. In 123D design, probably the most one of the most common things that you do all the time is, you saw me do it just a second ago, when things are kind of all over the all over your build plate here, you need them to both be on the grid or on the same level to print correctly. If you don't, they won't print correctly. So if I tried to print these right now, this piece would print fine. This one would look like spaghetti because it would never stick to the build plate because it's not the same level. So the easiest way to do this is to use a shortcut, and this is the one I use all the time in 123D design. And what is it? Super easy. It's just select the object and hit D, and it drops it all the way down to the plate. So awesome to learn some keyboard shortcuts and figure out the ones that you're going to use all the time, but that is probably by far my favorite shortcut. And now I don't have to worry about trying to align these two models to get them to print correctly. I know if I just hit D, they drop right down to the plate, and they're going to print awesome. The next thing I want to show you is the fact that you need to start to think in terms of, if you want to take your design to the next level, think in terms of repeated parts or duplicated parts. This piece right here probably doesn't look that complex or that familiar to you, but what's really interesting is this is the first joint I really made, and I've been using it ever since. The joint portion of this, as I basically have a ball and a socket joint, and both of them took me a little while to work on and get them to fit right and everything else, and we'll talk about the fit in just a second. But what I want you to notice is that once you have, especially like a mechanical type part that works pretty well for you, all you really have to do is Control C, Control V, and you know, start copying that part, and you can start to do really, really amazing things once you have a piece of your model that works really well. Now, what I'm showing you is, if you, hopefully, you'll start to see what this is. If I just take this and I double it up, and maybe I want to twist it a little bit or something like that, what I end up with is now I have a ball and socket joint on both sides that I can use. And great example of that, this might look familiar to you, but I don't know, this is actually the legs portion of my current figure model that you can download on Thingiverse for free. And I've uploaded the design files for you to mess with as well. But I wanted to show you, you know, what you can do by just repeating parts. Once you get a part that fits or works really well for you, you can just repeat that part, and that's the hardest part of building a model. But once you you duplicate the part, you know it's going to work throughout your model. So start thinking of terms of just duplicating parts. And obviously, what did I do here? I started with one ball and socket joint, then I repeated it, glued it to the other one, and then I needed one for the other side, so I just simply mirrored it. And it was really that simple. I made a line and I said copy and mirror the piece, and now I have a leg for both sides. So think about in terms of once you get a piece that works for you, or a mechanical piece especially, in your model, then you can sit there and just repeat that piece throughout your model and you know it's going to work. So think in terms of repeated parts. The next thing I want to talk about is tolerances. And this is something that took me a little while to grasp, that is for sure. I tended to print out things and then try them again and again and try to get them to fit correctly. And then finally it just dawned on me, hey man, there's probably some people who have done the same thing, a lot of professionals that have done it and have figured out the actual tolerances between pieces. And I'm going to give you a few off the top of my head to help you get started. When you're working with plastic, don't just say cut this sphere out of this piece and expect them to fit together perfectly, because they're not. Because when you print things, they end up printing a little bit bigger than you originally designed them. So what's going to happen is both these pieces are going to print just a tiny bit bigger than when you designed them. So they're probably not going to fit perfectly like they do in your software. So what I found is a good rule of thumb is around half a millimeter. So if I can design this piece about a half a millimeter smaller than this piece, they're going to fit together really, really well. Anywhere from 0.2 to 0.5 of a millimeter is a great place to start, and then you can tweak it from there. Another way I've done it before is if I don't want to mess with the actual math, all I'll do is I'll take a piece that I know is the perfect size. So if this fit perfectly in here, I would just take this piece and then I would do it. I would shrink it down like 2%. So then I would just go here and I would scale it and I would tell it to be like a factor of 0.98 or something like that. So that is another way you can get your tolerances, at least a good place to start. So that's my recommendation.
Now, if you're like me, of course, you're around computers a lot during your day-to-day, and we're all very used to using the common mouse. The problem with using a mouse when you're doing a 3D design, though, is it'll start to drive you crazy, because if you do any lengthy amount of gaming or even 3D design, you'll know that you can really, your hand can start to cramp up when you're using a mouse. The reason for this is because you use what I call the claw. When you grasp a mouse, just the common mouse, you generally move the mouse around with these two fingers. And then, of course, you use a lot of the button actions and combos when you're doing 3D design. Now, the problem with that is with all these crazy combos using the buttons, using this clawing action to move your mouse around, especially for big movements like left and right when you're rotating objects and things, your hand will really start to cramp up. Well, here's a trick that I think is at least worth a try for you. I didn't think I would like it and ended up loving it. And that is using what's called a trackball. Now, Logitech makes trackballs, and they have a couple of different models, but their newest one works absolutely great. The concept here is pretty simple. When I put this down here on my mouse pad, it's very easy and comfortable to use because I don't have to move the mouse back and forth at all. It just sits still. To do the motion of it, you simply use your thumb. And what's really, really cool about that is the fact that your palm simply rests on top of the mouse and it doesn't cramp up. Now, I promise you, what's really wild about this is at first it does feel pretty awkward, but you will fall in love very quickly with it because your hand simply doesn't get tired. It's really pretty wild. The other cool thing is large motions, say back and forth across your screen, are really easy with a trackball because all you have to do is flick the trackball to one side or the other and your mouse goes screaming across the screen really, really quick. And that makes big movements really, really easy. So if you get a chance, try a trackball. And if you just see one in a store, check it out. You'd be really surprised. Go on Amazon and you'll see trackballs the old models going for like $300. That's because once people learn to use it, they absolutely love it. And they actually love the older models just as well or even more. So they're willing to pay up to $200-$300 for these old models of trackballs because they all work great. And the older models people have gotten used to, and they can't stand it. They can't have their old trackball anymore. So give it a shot. Try a trackball. 3D mouse, or as a lot of people refer to it as the space mouse, is a really, really cool piece of gear. And you don't have to get a very expensive one. This is one of the nicer ones, but you don't need an expensive one to get all of the functions that you really use. The way a space mouse works is simply you control it with this big dial looking thing. But the trick is the dial moves up, down, left, right, and in every direction. What's really, really cool about that is the fact that you can take a model, and in most modeling software, if you just pull up on it, the model moves up. If you pull the dome thing back towards you, the model actually gets closer to you. It's really cool. You twist it left or right, it twists left or right, you know, tilt it back and forth, whatever. It becomes really, really handy, and it's really cool. And you really can't grasp how cool this is until you actually try it. So if you ever get an opportunity to try out a space mouse, it's awesome. Now, just like I said, I love this one because it's a little bit bigger. This is kind of the expensive model of the 3D connection one. It's about $200, maybe a little bit more. I don't exactly remember. But the main reason for this one is it has all these extra buttons. I don't actually use the buttons that much. I'm sure I will once I get a little bit more into it. But really, they're just shortcut buttons. They have a much cheaper model that simply gives you the motion of the space mouse itself, and it's much cheaper, and it would be a great place for anybody to start. But if you've never messed with a 3D mouse before or a space mouse, man, it is awesome, and it is totally worth the investment, I promise, if you really want to get into 3D design.
Next thing I wanted to talk to you about is the fact that when you go out there and you see all the designs that have been 3D designed for 3D printing, a lot of them are simply just designs. Well, I love this concept of building off of existing materials. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. Somebody's already done it. Well, somebody has already designed and made very cheap, very strong materials. My favorite is PVC pipe. So what I want you to start to think about is taking existing materials that are cheap and easy to use and then doing 3D design around them. So this is a filament holder that I designed. And what's so cool about it is it basically, all the big parts are PVC pipe, and all I designed was the connectors and the rollers that go on the PVC pipes. And this thing works awesome, and it's super easy to use. But the biggest thing is I want you to understand is that you don't need to redesign things that are already out there and simple and easy to use. So you can use wood, you know, and the mixture of 3D printed parts and wood looks really cool. PVC is awesome because it paints very well. And of course, PLA and ABS that you use for 3D printing both also paint very well. So they hold paint awesome, they hold colors, so you can do all sorts of things. So the biggest thing is I want you to start thinking out of the box and start trying to think on how that you can add to existing design that's already out there and is really easy to use. 3D design can be daunting at first, especially with all the different 3D design and modeling software that's out there. That you have a ton of choices, and it can be really overwhelming to try to learn a new software. And then if you get frustrated with that one, try another one. And you can bounce from software to software, and then you start to get frustrated pretty quick. Taking a design from a drawing or a concept in your head and actually getting it all the way to your 3D printer can be a challenge, but if you stick with it, it becomes very rewarding each time, because that flash to bang, that, you know, drawn design to a physical object can happen really very, very quickly as you start to get better. A great example is, I want you to understand that we all have our weaknesses, all right? I'm really good at creating mechanical type designs. This is actually a lightsaber, and you're gonna see it coming up in a project here pretty soon. And it looks really complex,
but it's really not. It was just a bunch of shapes I put together and it looks really cool. Well, even I have my design weaknesses. I'm great at like mechanical type parts. Like I know you've seen my robot guy and things like that. Well, the aspect of design that I'm still really struggling with and still working with is the sculpting aspect. There are a ton of 3D sculptors out there that are great at making giant robot monsters and these crazy like sculpted 3D designs. That is really challenging for me, and I'm going to get there. But remember, I had to start somewhere as well, and starting with mechanical type designs and then working your way into the more artsy type sculpting designs is, I think, a great place to start. But the biggest thing is don't get frustrated. I remember trying to pick up 3D design well before 3D printers and MakerBots were even around. I remember I started with Blender and I was completely overwhelmed because I struggled with Blender, and then I forced myself. I said, no, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to learn this no matter how long it takes because I want to be able to do this in the future. I gave up. All right, I still to this day cannot get Blender. It drives me crazy. It's so hard to use. But that's why I point you in the direction of some of these other new 3D design software sets, because once I started to learn those, all of a sudden, all the burden of trying to learn an overwhelming software suite was gone, because 123D design and Tinkercad and all these really easy designs like SketchUp, Google SketchUp, once they came onto the scene, they really closed the gap in the learning curve, and it became much easier to learn 3D design. And that's when my design started to take off. So stick with it, and if you really start having trouble, try a different program, but try not to jump from program to program, because that can be even more frustrating at first. If you're like me, you can definitely get designer's block and you get really frustrated. You're like, oh, I want to make something cool, but I just cannot think of something new right now. Well, let me tell you something. The best place to look for innovation is all around you. 3D design has been around for a long, long time. And you can find some of the most cool aspects of 3D design and get ideas from some really common things around you. One of my favorites is, think about what happens when like 1,000 engineers and designers get together and they just, you know, bash skulls and try to figure out a new design. Well, a great example of that is the modern game controller. If you really take a look at the thought and that went into the modern game controller, you'd really be surprised, but you've got to take a closer look, because this is definitely one of those things you really take for granted. The fact that it's a perfect weight and it's balanced in your hand, the fact that it's really comfortable for big hands and little hands, the fact that a big hand and a little hand can reach all the buttons on a game controller, these are a lot of the little things that you don't even think about until you take a closer look. You know, another great example of something that has been morphed for, you know, I want to say hundreds of years. Okay, not quite hundreds of years, but a long, long time, is the common mouse. All right, you see so many different versions of this simple tool, but they're continuing to evolve. You know, and I showed you the trackball, but I want to show you something that I couldn't live without and is definitely one of my favorite and most inspirational designs. And I love my Dyson vacuum cleaner. I know it sounds ridiculous, but if you know any of the history behind the Dyson vacuum cleaner, it's actually really, really interesting. Dyson actually, it took him years and years and years to develop the Dyson vacuum cleaner, and he went through hundreds upon hundreds of prototypes to actually get it to work. There's some really amazing technology behind it, and one of them is the fact that centrifugal motion pushes dust outwards from the air when it swirls the air through like a vortex. What's really cool is, you might not know this, but that same technology is in a bunch of different things. I'm in the military and I've been working with tanks for years. Well, tanks use the same technology and the same concept to keep dust from getting sucked into the jet engine that they run off of. And the idea was not originally Dyson's. That's what's so cool. He actually saw it in a sawmill, and the sawmill was using this vortex motion to push sawdust out of the air so it didn't clog up the machines. So think about it. Don't feel like you always have to come up with something brand new. Look for inspiration all around you, and you're going to find some amazing designs. Well, there it is. There's 10 quick tips, or at least to get you thinking out of the box and give you a better perspective of 3D design when it comes to 3D printing. Now, just like I said, the biggest thing is to think out of the box and don't get frustrated. But there are a ton of aspects of 3D design that are super cool. And the fact that you can take a concept all the way to a 3D printed object in your own home is really revolutionary. And that's why I think 3D printing has got nowhere but up to grow, because it is pretty cool. But the learning curve is in the design. So stick with it. If you've got any questions, you know where to check me out here on my YouTube channel. And Commando Designs will point you back to my YouTube channel right now. So if you got any questions, post them in the comments and tell me what you think, and don't forget to subscribe. Well, that's awesome. I'm actually surprised you stuck around this long. Usually people click onto the next video pretty quick as soon as they see the screen go dark. But all I wanted to do is give you just a quick heads up of what's coming up in the future. I'm just getting settled in my new place. I just moved across the country, and I've got a bunch of cool new projects on the docket. We're gonna get back to paint, I promise. So I know you guys are freaking out about me doing more paint projects. So some paint projects that are coming up. I'm going to show you this amazing cool lightsaber effect that is great for Halloween, that will blow people's minds. That's one paint effect I got coming up. Another one is the swirl paint effect. Guys have been just killing me with emails telling me to do the whole dip, paint swirl thing. It's actually really easy, and I can't wait to show you that one too. As far as 3D design, man, I got a ton of stuff on the docket, and I'm excited to show you. Just like I said, part of my lightsaber project is the lightsaber handle that I designed, and I'll show you how easy that was. So stick with me, subscribe, tell your friends, and if you got any questions, you know where to check me out. I'm Tony D.